Thank you, Ali. Yes, we have changed our name as of October 1st, and this is our new logo that we just got, a month or so ago. So I put that on there. Let me hit these lights, you can see it better. As Dr. Tabatabai said, I have a number of co-authors here. So this is one of these projects where a bunch of us got together. This would have been about 2006. And decided we were interested in manure application. A lot of people were working on that, and we got together to develop a project to look at low disturbance, a low disturbance application system. Tom Moorman is a microbiologist, works with us. He helped a lot with the rainfall simulation, which I'll talk about. Cindy Camberdella is an ecologist. She does a lot of work with carbon and nitrogen, so she's involved with this project and has done a lot of work with N15, as you'll see. Jeremy Singer is our agronomist, and so he's dealing with the cover crops and with the crop production in the field. And Mark Tomer is, I guess he's a hydrogeologist, but he's dealing with nitrate and nutrient leaching in general, and he's running some lysimeters out in the plots that I'll show you in a minute. So we all got together and developed this project. I will tell you that I'm going to present some results. But this is, I guess, last fall, 2009, was the only 2 years into a six-year project. So the data I'm presenting are very preliminary. With that, I'll see if I can go on. We started out thinking about nutrients and the problems we have with nutrients. And if you look here, if anyone went to the Iowa Water Conference the last couple of days, you probably have seen this slide three or four times anyway. And it shows in the Gulf of Mexico, there's the issue with hypoxia in the Gulf, and most people think it's a result of too many nutrients going down the Mississippi River and causing the problem. And so if you look at the sources of the nutrients delivered to the Gulf of Mexico, you see for phosphorus and for nitrogen in particular, corn and soybean production in the upper part of the Mississippi River Basin have been implicated in causing the nutrient problems down there. And so that makes it a very interesting topic. If you bring it a little closer to home, we see in, I guess I'll use this pointer up here. Phosphorus, this was taken just northwest of town here in a farmer's field. We were doing some work, and I happened to look down here. There was animal production going on close by, and a lot of manure was applied. This happens to be some CRP ground, but on the other side up here that you can't see was a cornfield. And manure was applied many years to that cornfield. And what happened was we had this algae bloom in the early spring. You can see that not a lot is growing out here right now, but the pond certainly is green, or the little water area, I guess it's a pond, is green. Also the problems with nitrogen, because we have a lot of tile drainage, nitrate's very mobile and flows into the water, and so we lose a lot of that as well, and it causes problems for the water in Iowa. So it's not just the Gulf of Mexico where we're having problems. We decided to work with swine manure. There's a lot of swine production in Iowa, a lot of manure to use on the land. This is a shot up in Hardin County that I took before the growing season began, and it shows how many of these swine facilities there are, and probably the manure from these facilities will be applied to these lands here. Generally, application occurs in a few different ways. One of the ways is through one of these knife injection systems. So the manure is knifed into the ground. The liquid ends up 5-6 inches down, 15 centimeters, 12-15 centimeters down. Also, the farmer up in Hardin County that is collaborating with us, he puts it on with one of these splash-type applicators. So the manure simply runs out here, and then the soil is turned up over the top of it. And if you can see this in the back, a lot of the manure still ends up on the soil surface. So you can imagine if we get a rainfall after that, that's going to cause some problems, and we're going to lose phosphorus. Now, those two applicators that we talked about, the big knife applicator and also the splash applicator, what happens if you want to put manure on a ground like this where you have a cover crop growing? That presents a problem if you don't want to tear up the cover crop and cause problems for it. So that's why we went to a low disturbance applicator. The unit we chose was a Yetter Avenger, and this slide shows that. This is the unit. These are a couple of slides I took from their website, so it's nothing special here for us. But it shows the applicator. I guess I should stay over here. So this disc or this coulter here cuts a volume of soil away, or actually pushes it away. So this is offset just 5 degrees, I believe it is. So it creates a void behind it. And then right here, this tube is where the manure comes in through this tube and goes down right into that void. And so then there are a couple of packing type wheels back here that sort of close that up or firm up the ground behind it. Here's a shot of it working in a no-till system. So it doesn't disturb soil very much at all. And we thought this would be a great way of trying to apply manure, liquid swine manure, without disturbing the cover crop that was there. So our objectives, or a couple of our objectives for this project anyway, are to determine phosphorus fate and transport following both conventional and low disturbance swine manure application in a corn soybean production system with and without a cereal rye. Actually, there's some oats in there as well, a rye oat cover crop. And then to quantify uptake of manure derived in by the cover crop and the subsequent corn crop after the fall application of N15 labeled swine manure. So this is one of the interesting parts. I'm not actually involved in a lot in the N15 work, but it's exciting because of the way we're doing it. So growing N15 labeled corn, as you might imagine, if you want N15 labeled swine manure, you cannot go to Fisher and buy it. You have to make your own. So that's what the crew decided to do. You can get N15 labeled fertilizer, but not manure. So we went to the greenhouse. Planted some corn plants. We had to plant a lot of corn plants in order to generate enough grain so that we could feed that grain. So all these plants that you see in the greenhouse here, all these pots, we had plants growing in them, grew them to maturity, produced the corn, harvested the N15 labeled corn, and then took that corn and fed it to hogs, and then collected the manure. Or as one of the guys over in animal science says, the product. So we collected the product to be used in our field application. Some details on the N15 labeled corn. We pulse labeled with potassium nitrate fertilizer at V7, V12, and again an anthesis. So there was less than a gram of N15 per pot being added. This was added as a solution, and we had the amount of water going into the pots controlled so that if any of it ran out, we would collect it and put it back in. So we didn't want to lose any of this solution that had N15 in it. The corn grain was harvested. We ended up with 68.8 kilograms of grain with that atom percent of N15, and then we fed it to the hogs. Four pigs, they were fed for 9 days. We collected the swine manure in that facility. Let's see if I can go back to that. In that facility there, so we collected the swine manure. We ended up with 155 liters of product. And it had 1.8, 1.9 atom percent N15 in it. This much ammonium, and the rest was organic N. So that was the material that we had, the manure that we had, the liquid manure that we had that was applied to the plots. Some information on our plots then. This is out at the Boyd Research Center.
Thank you for watching the Agronomist Podcast. YouTube limits video lengths to 10 minutes. You can watch this seminar in its entirety at the Department of Agronomy website, www.agron.iastate.edu.